Okay, so good morning everyone. Welcome back to CS307 Computer Networks. Today we'll be covering we'll be starting chapter number 2, which is about application layer. This is the fourth lecture of your online sessions. The second chapter is also from the same book, Computer Networking, a Top-Down Approach, 6th edition, the one that we are following by Q. Ross and Ross. So this is a brief outline of the entire chapter. 2.1 is Principles of Network Applications. Then we'll specifically look at web applications and hypertext transfer protocol. Then we'll move on to file transfer protocol or FTP. Then we'll look at the principle or working principle behind different types of email protocols such as SMTP, POP3 and IMAP. Section 2.5 will be on domain naming systems. 2.6 will be P2P applications. We'll very briefly touch on P2P applications without going into a lot of detail. 2.7 is socket programming with UDP and TCP. This will be reinforced by your labs on the same subject, that is socket programming. So moving on, what are our goals for understanding or studying application layer? First of all, it is going to be conceptual implementation of different aspects of network application protocols. Okay. We look at transport layer service models, we look at client-server paradigm, what is the difference between client-server and peer-to-peer communication. We'll also learn about different protocols which are very popular at the application layer, especially when it comes to web services. So we look at HTTP, FTP, mail transfer protocols such as SMTP, POP3 as well as IMAP. And then we will look at how to basically translate IP addresses into website names or domain names and vice versa. And that will be studied under the topic of DNS, domain naming system. And then finally, creating network related applications, which is how to expose the socket APIs. Okay. So some of the network related applications which are quite popular and which are available these days, and most of you would have used at least a few of these, if not all of these: email, web services. You can even send text messages via some network applications, remotely log in into different systems to manage them, such as applications such as TeamViewer. They are quite popular. P2P file sharing, so you would have used some kind of torrents. Multi-user network games, a lot of games are online, and they basically involve participants from maybe the same region or different regions across the globe. You can participate in such network games. Streaming is very popular. YouTube, Hulu is very popular in North America. And then globally, we have web streaming services, or let's say video streaming services such as Netflix. Okay. In addition to these, we also use network apps for business related applications, voice over IP, example Skype, that is popular. These days, online teaching is being carried out using Google Meet. Then another example is Zoom. Okay. Real-time video conferencing is also possible, either through the use of proprietary applications or in-house developed applications by different kinds of organizations. Social networking, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, etc. And then mainly to browse the actual internet. Okay, so search-related applications such as plugins for Google search engine or other search engines, etc., etc. So a lot of network applications are available, and most of us have come across at least a few of these, if not all of these applications. How do we create a network-related application, or what are the basic components? We can write programs that run on different end systems. So it could be a Linux-based system, it could be a Windows-based system. But these systems and these network applications which are running on top of these end systems can communicate with each other over a network. Okay, the network being the internet in this case. Example is web server software that communicates with browser software. So you have Firefox, Internet Explorer, Microsoft Edge, Google Chrome, Opera web browser. Different types of web browsers which are just applications running on top of end systems. The end systems can be running different types of operating systems. But these web software or these web applications can communicate with web browser software running on a different system across the network or across the internet. And you can actually peruse, or you can investigate what are the files that are available on that particular web server, which are available for you to download and view. Okay. Usually, we do not write software for network core devices, such as packet switches. So if you were to develop an application for a router or a switch, generally that is the outside the scope of normal services or normal engineering works. it is the manufacturer of that device, such as Cisco, Juniper, other different vendors such as Huawei, who are going to write the application or write the operating system for that particular network core component, such as a packet or a switch. Okay. So what we are interested in this particular chapter or in this particular course is not actually the development of software or applications running on network components, that is routers or switches, but instead working with applications which run on end systems and make use of the internet. So at each of these different components, you can see that you have the five layers of the TCP/IP stack running, that is on the web server as well as on the end systems. And they communicate with each other using the encapsulation and de-encapsulation method that we studied while we were reviewing OSI referencing model in the previous chapter. The possible structure of these applications that are going to run on end systems is either client-server or it is peer-to-peer. Okay, so two different types of paradigms are available to us whenever we are writing these applications, that is network applications. With a client-server architecture, the actual implementation is quite simplistic. You have a server software that is running on one system that is always on, okay? So it is always listening for incoming connections. Usually it has a permanent IP address so that you can communicate with that that particular web service or web server without any issues. And these servers are usually implemented or let's say placed in data centers, okay? That makes it very easy to manage them because all the servers are in a single place, okay? Rather than having them dispersed throughout the organization. Then the second component of the client-server architecture is clients. The clients are another piece of software or application which is running on an end system that communicates with the server software. Okay, the client need not always be on like a server, so it is only switched on when there is a requirement of connecting the client to the actual web server, whereas a web server is usually always on. Clients can have dynamic IP addresses. It does not really matter if you have an IP address that is changing every 24 hours. It does not really matter in terms of communicating with the web server, and the web server IP address is usually fixed. Okay. Clients usually do not communicate directly with each other. Okay. Clients only communicate with servers. So if you want two computers to communicate with each other using a client-server architecture, then at least one of them should be a client and one of them should be performing as a server. The client and server are actually just applications or let's say piece of software that is running on these end systems, okay? It's not that the entire server is going to be just server software. It can have other services running as well, okay? It can also behave as a client under certain circumstances. But the server and the client, okay, the roles can change, as well as we need to understand that the client and server itself is just a piece of server software and a piece of client software that is running on top of the operating system. The second major paradigm is peer-to-peer architecture. In peer-to-peer architecture, there is no client and server as such. Okay, so there is no always-on server. There are just arbitrary end systems that are directly communicating with each other. Okay, so both of them can behave as a client and both of them can behave as a server. Okay, these systems, let's say, they are called peers. Okay, these peers request service from other peers, other computers. And those peers provide a service in return to other peers. Okay. It is self-scalable. We use the term self-scalability when it comes to peer-to-peer architecture. There can be new peers or new end systems which are bringing or adding capacity to the system. So say for example, if you are using a torrent-related application such as BitTorrent, you would have seen that once you get a seed for a particular torrent, there are multiple parties which are in parallel communicating with you or sending information to you, and in turn you are also uploading some information. Depending on the number of peers that are available, it can significantly affect the time it involves in downloading a particular application, okay, or in uploading a particular application. So as you have more peers coming online and joining the network, that basically means that your service capacity is going to improve. Okay, so that is directly proportional to the number of peers. Okay. Generally speaking, there are certain scenarios in which adding further peers can also limit the throughput of the entire system. Okay. The peers are intermittently connected and they can change their IP addresses. Okay. Obviously, if two end systems are communicating with each other and they are behaving as peers, but one of them automatically changes their IP address, then that becomes an issue because you will not know where to send the information to or where to download the information from. So the management is slightly more complex as compared to client server architecture. One of the let's say systems that is available to resolve this issue is that you have a directory listing service, okay, or a directory service that is one central server which is basically going to hold the information about the different peers which are available in the network and automatically track the IP addresses or changes to the IP addresses of those systems. So that if a peer changes its IP address halfway through communication or otherwise, then you have a central repository of information, another server which is basically going to inform you or through which you can check what is the latest IP address. Okay, so that is something that is used by some of the torrent applications. Okay, in addition to this, you have another example such as Skype. Okay, whenever you are making a Skype call, you are just logging in with your username and password, and in your contacts you have saved multiple different let's say peers or different contacts. Obviously those contacts are, most of them are running on private end systems, okay, such as laptops or mobile phones. So whenever you want to communicate with someone, it is quite likely that they'll have an IP address that is different from the previous session when you were communicating with them. So how do we find the most recent IP address or the live IP address of any other of our contacts in Skype? There is a central Skype service or let's say Skype directory, which is, as soon as you log in with your username and password, it is going to record your IP address, okay, for that particular timestamp or that particular session. And whenever somebody else from your contacts also logs in with their username and password, the same information, the IP address of their system, will get updated on the Skype server. So as soon as you initiate a call, the call first goes to the Skype server. The Skype server provides the IP address of the relevant client or the relevant peer, and then you maintain direct communication with that peer. Okay, usually direct communication with the other peer. So because there is no because this is a peer-to-peer architecture, or let's say an example of a relative peer-to-peer architecture, the management is quite complex because of changing IP addresses. Okay, so you need to have some kind of an intermediate broker, especially if your end systems or your peers are changing their IP addresses quite frequently. In general, we have processes communicating with each other, whether we are using client services or we are using peer-to-peer services. Okay, what is a process? Okay, a program that is running clients and servers within a host. Within the same host, you can have two processes communicating with each other. That is called as inter-process communication. Okay, and that inter-process communication is defined by the operating system. You would have studied it in operating systems course, what is inter-process communication. Okay, so there are two different forms of inter-process communication. If you jog your memory a bit, you will maybe you will be able to recall what these are. One of them was message based or message passing between different processes, and the second one, I guess I will leave it to you to find out what was the second form of inter-process communication. Okay, so try to determine what were the two different methods available for inter-process communication. One was message-based. Try to determine yourself or recall from the course what was the other one. Okay, the processes can be run in different hosts, and they communicate by exchanging messages, okay, generally over the network. Okay, the client process is a process that initiates the communication, and the server process, which is basically the server software running on the other end system, is a process that waits to be contacted by a client process. Okay, the applications which are running peer-to-peer architecture run both of these in parallel, so they have both the client processes as well as the server processes running inside them. Okay, the architecture is peer-to-peer, but the peer can behave as a client as well as a server. Then what are sockets? You will study this in the lab if you haven't already. Sockets are processes that are used to send and receive messages, and they can be let's say they are just pieces of software, okay, which are running on different operating systems, and you can initiate multiple different sockets or multiple different let's say doors. Okay, so the analogy is that this is a door that you need to open in the operating system in order to communicate over the network. Okay, so you can have the option of using multiple different sockets simultaneously over an operating system. Okay, The sending process sends the message to the outside door, okay, to the socket, and the sending process then relies on the transport infrastructure, or let's say the network infrastructure on the other side of the door, to deliver the message to socket at the receiving process. Okay, so this is an actual illustration, a diagram that illustrates it. You have an application or process that wants to communicate with the network stack. It can communicate with the network stack by opening a door in the operating system, which we call a socket. Using a socket, we can pass on the message to the network stack, which is the combination of your application, transport, network link, and physical layer. Okay. And on the receiving side, you have another socket which is open and which is listening for information. So as soon as the information arrives in the network stack can pass on this information to the relevant process using the socket or the incoming socket or the incoming door on the receiving side. Okay. What is the addressing process? That to receive messages, the process must have an identifier. Okay. The host device has a unique 32-bit IP address, so we can identify the end system by an IP address, a 32-bit IP address. Okay, but does the IP address of the host on which the process runs is sufficient for identifying the process? No, because there can be multiple different processes on that particular end system or host that is communicating over the network. So you can identify the host by the 32-bit IP address, but once the information or the message arrives inside the host, then the host needs to determine which particular process or which particular program we need to forward this message to. In order to identify that program, we have something called a process identifier. Okay, the process identifier in turn is directly mapped to something called a port number. Okay, a port number. So using that port number, we can forward the information to that port, and the port is going to forward it to the relevant identifier. Okay, so the processes can be identified by port numbers. Okay, that is the identifier for that particular process. So the identifier will now include both the IP address to we can forward it to the relevant application that is associated with that port number. Some of the port numbers are registered port numbers. Okay, so HTTP is always going to use port number 80. Mail server is always going to use port number 25. Okay, so once we want to send a HTTP message to this web server, which is the computer science department at University of Massachusetts, okay, we know the IP address of that web server ends is 128.119.245.12, but the same server can be running file services, print services, etc. So we need to identify on which particular port we need to send this message, because we are interested in downloading the web page via HTTP. So we know that the HTTP is always going to operate on port number 80. That is the registered port number for HTTP. So we are going to use a combination of this IP address and port number, which is called the socket, to communicate with that particular HTTP server. There can be different types of messages that are exchanged. It can be a request such as get, a response such as send. Okay. The message syntax is basically defines what are the fields in the messages and how the fields are delineated. Okay. So what is the actual format of the messages? Then the semantics, what is the meaning of information in the fields? If I get something like get, does it mean that I need to send something, or does it mean that I'm fetching information? Things like that. Okay. So whether it is get, post, put, etc., those kinds of different methods. And the rules for when and how to process the send and response messages. So all of that is defined by the application layer protocol, such as HTTP, FTP, etc. These different protocols are going to define at least these four different components or four different avenues. The protocols, like I explained in the previous lectures, are defined in request for comments. And because they are publicly available, so it allows for interoperability between different types of end systems. Okay, so you can have HTTP or SMTP running on Linux or on Windows-based systems or on Android platforms, and they are going to behave in the same way. Okay, in addition to open protocols, there are proprietary protocols such as Skype. Okay, so you need to download the Skype application on your Linux machine or on your Windows machine or Android platform before you can actually start using Skype. Although there is an online service available as well, but generally what we do is we download the Skype application before we start using it. So if the application is or the protocol is available for your end system, such as if you are running popular Linux or popular Windows versions, that is fine. If you are running an operating system that you have designed or developed yourself, then you will need to have some kind of Skype plugins or some kind of APIs that are going to integrate Skype with your system. Okay? Otherwise, these proprietary protocols are not going to work. It then depends on Skype whether they are able to provide you with the relevant information so you can develop or you can write the Skype application for your system. Whereas with open protocols such as HTTP or SMTP or FTP, because these are defined in request for commands and they are publicly available, so you can write the piece of software just by looking at the specification which is available online. Whereas with proprietary protocols such as Skype, you need the actual provider of that application, in this case Microsoft for Skype, so they can give you the information so you can develop the application because it is proprietary. What kinds of transport services does an application need? First of all, do you need to include data integrity? Okay, some applications such as file transfers or web transactions require 100% reliable data transfer if you are using banking or finance related applications. Whereas audio or video applications, even if there is some kind of a loss in the actual streaming, due to the sheer speed of the frames per second, if you lose one or two frames, it is quite likely that you are not even going to notice it. So when we are writing the application, we need to determine whether we need data integrity or reliability or not. Okay. Then the timing. How much time is it going to involve to actually communicate with the other party? If it is a telephone-based application such as Skype, then obviously the latency or the delay needs to be low enough so that when you are communicating with someone, it appears like a live communication. It's not like I say something and then I need to wait for maybe a certain amount of time before the message gets communicated to the other party. They're able to listen to the message and then reply back to me. Okay. So timing or latency is very important whenever you are writing applications. So determining on the nature of the application, you will need to keep in mind how much time is actually needed for the communication or what are the latency parameters. Then the throughput. Some applications require minimum throughput to be effective. Okay, so if you are using file transfer or if you are using, let's say generally, you are transferring a very small amount of data such as the temperature in a particular room that is sent by one thermal sensor to a central server, then that is just two digits or maybe three digits. Okay, so that is going to be a very small amount of data and that it does not require that much throughput. Whereas if you require web streaming or video streaming, then that is obviously going to use a lot of throughput or a lot of bandwidth. We call these applications, some of these applications are elastic applications. That is, they can automatically fine tune themselves according to the bandwidth that is available. You would have seen in YouTube as well, if you have a very good internet connection and you are playing a video, it will automatically improve the actual, the resolution of that video. Whereas if it is a very low bandwidth connection, it will automatically reduce itself to the minimum resolution that is available for that particular video. So we call these applications elastic applications because they can dynamically adjust themselves or adjust the actual sequence or frame playing sequence or the resolution, let's say, depending on the underlying bandwidth that is available. So the application is measuring the bandwidth and according to the bandwidth, it is automatically making a decision that I need to send this much amount of data or play back at this particular frame rate. Okay. Then finally, security, whether you need encryption and data integrity and data availability for your actual application. If it is a banking related application or you are making some transactions such as buying or selling something online, then obviously it needs to have some kind of encryption. Okay, so these are some of the applications that are available and their requirements for data loss as well as throughput and whether they are time sensitive or not. So if it is file transfer, then it should ideally have no data loss. The throughput should be elastic and it is not time sensitive. Let's say we want to transfer something. We are at liberty to say that, okay, even if it takes 11 minutes instead of, let's say, 5 minutes, then that is fine as long as the file is getting transferred. Obviously, it is going to delay it, but it is not going to have a very big effect on the actual performance of the system. Whereas if it is real-time audio and video, then yes, it is very time sensitive. If it is more than hundreds of milliseconds, then you are going to have a very bad user experience. Okay, then you have interactive games which are less loss tolerant, and yes, they also are time sensitive. Okay, and you need to have at least a few kilobits per second of throughput. Okay, These days, some of the interactive games for that, even a few kilobits per second are not enough. You need to have at least tens or, let's say tens of megabits per second at the minimum available. Okay. Finally, text messaging. There is no data loss and it is elastic, but it can be time sensitive or it cannot be time sensitive depending on what you are using the text messaging for. Okay. So make sure that in your spare time you go through this table once again and try to understand each of the applications and what do we mean in terms of their throughput and data loss requirements as well as the latency. The internet transport protocol is of two types. One is reliable and the other one is unreliable. Okay, so TCP service or transmission control protocol is a reliable transport service that ensures that there is, even if there is packet loss between the sending and receiving processes, we can actually retransmit those packets that are lost. Okay, it ensures flow control that the sender won't overwhelm the receiver. If the receiver is running out of buffer, then we are going to slow down, okay, the amount of data that we are transmitting to the receiver. Congestion control, the throttle the sender or basically reduce the amount of data that is being sent when the network gets overloaded, or when the network devices such as routers or switches get overloaded, then we can have some kind of congestion control specifically for routers. It does not provide for timing and minimum throughput guarantees, and it does not provide security either. Okay, it just ensures that if you have packet loss, then the sender is going to know that there was packet loss and it is going to retransmit the same packet again. Okay. We will look into the actual interplay of how, or the actual specification of how TCP integrates with the different types of end systems and what are the different congestion control algorithms that are available to us. Okay. That is going to be the topic of chapter number 3. Okay. Finally, TCP is connection oriented, that is, a call is set up between the sender and the receiver and a few configuration items are agreed upon before the client can start communicating with the server process. Okay. On the other hand, you have UDP, which is User Datagram Protocol, which is an unreliable data transfer service, sending data between the sending and the receiving process. It does not provide for reliability, flow control, congestion control, latency, throughput guarantee, security, or it does not have any connection setup either. So it is not a connection-oriented protocol. Okay, both of these protocols, TCP and UDP, are available at the transport layer. Okay. So the question now arises that if UDP is so bad, okay, in terms of unreliability, then why is UDP there in the first place? What is the main advantage of having UDP? Because as you look at the UDP service description, all we can see is the disadvantages. So if there are so many disadvantages, then what might be the advantage of having a UDP service that it is still being used? Okay, so that is something for you guys to consider and something that we are going to discuss in the online live session. So these are again the same set of applications or similar applications, and in the application layer protocol, it defines what type of application layer protocol we are using. So email is using SMTP, and remote terminal access is using Telnet, web is HTTP, file transfer is FTP, streaming can be HTTP or RTP, which stands for real-time protocol. Internet telephone is SIP or again RTP. SIP is session initiation protocol. Okay. And then at the transport layer, it specifies whether it is using TCP or UDP. So at the application layer, we are using these protocols, okay, the second column for each of these applications. And at the transport layer, we have the option of either using TCP or UDP. So it specifies which particular protocol we use for each of these applications. How do you secure TCP? So see, TCP does not provide any security by default. We secure TCP and UDP by adding another layer or calling on a different library, okay, whenever we open the socket. Okay. So the actual library that is available to us is Secure Socket Layer SSL. That provides some kind of encryption, okay, for all of our data, ensures data integrity, and then you have endpoint authentication as well. SSL operates at the application layer, so the application use SSL libraries, which in turn talk to TCP protocol, which is running at the transport layer. Okay. It has its own API, that is, clear text passwords are sent into socket, which traverse or travel through the internet in an encrypted way. Okay. Chapter number 7 of the 6th edition is primarily about network security or how to secure different types of transport layer protocols. So that brings us to the end of this particular lecture. If you have any questions, then please write them down and we can discuss them during the live session. Thank you.